enjoy Christmas time. Anybody in here with me? I love Christmas. I love Christmas music. It's amazing to me how I can be so into a certain style of music, like so crazy about it for like 4 weeks out of the year, you know? And how many of y'all, for me, it has to be traditional. How many of y'all like contemporary versus traditional? How many contemporaries in here? Contemporary, one person, good job, our bass player. Yes, of course. How many of y'all, it's gotta be traditional? Come on, man, yes. Some Dean Martin, come on, some of that stuff, right? Some Frank Sinatra. So anyway, this year, that's how it is for me. That's my Spotify Christmas channel. It's all those guys. And this year, one song kind of crept into my playlist. And man, I cannot get it out of my head. Chuck knows it because he's heard it a million times now. And so, you know that saying that misery loves company. So if you don't mind, could y'all cue it up back there for the rest of the church?
In the winter, when the snow comes to cover the ground.
Who has ever heard this song? Raise your hand.
It's time for play.
It's called A Marshmallow World in the Winter. Okay, enough of that. That's good. I just wanted to share that with you. You're welcome. You're welcome. So from now on, you're going to have that tune. It's so catchy for the maybe even next year, you'll still have it, okay? So anyway, just want to share that. Hey, Life of Christ study. We've been doing it now for, I don't know, about 4 months, 3 months, something like that. And I think you guys are growing in God. Is that right? You enjoying it? And so we're going to continue that today. But during this past week, you know, we looked at Jesus last week on the earth before he died. And you're like, Pastor, you know it's Christmas, not Easter, right? Yeah, I know that. But Jesus is with his friends. I want to bring you to John chapter 17. Jesus is with his friends, and he's praying to God. And look what he says to God. I have brought you glory. I'm going to key on that. You see what he's saying to God? This is what I did with my life. I brought you glory on earth by what? By finishing the work. Everybody say finish. Finishing the work you gave me to do. Now, man, I'm telling you, we are reminded, again, this week, we were looking at some of these devotional videos and the readings we were in. We were reminded of what Jesus endured for us, right? We were reminded of all the things, the way that Jesus, basically, he modeled everything that he taught us. He modeled it during the last week of his life, right? How to pray for your enemies, how to love them, how to forgive, even when he's on a cross. All even wrestling with the will of God. Remember the Garden of Gethsemane? And then yet, even though he's wrestling with it, ultimately choosing to obey God. And how many of y'all are thankful he did? Because he turned history around, right? That moment when he chose to obey God. And I thank God he suffered for us so we don't have to for our own sin. Amen? Anybody else happy about that? And then he actually rose again and went to heaven, sent us the Holy Spirit. Man, he did this for us. Yes, it was for us. But in this verse I just read, I actually see it another reason. It was to bring glory to God. Can y'all back up to that verse? I know y'all didn't know I was going to do this. Put that verse back up. Look at this. He said, I've brought you glory, God, by finishing the work. He's saying, oh, I'm obeying God. Why? Because I'm bringing glory to him. And guess who's the beneficiary? We are. And so here's the thing. Even though we don't have to go through what Jesus went through for our sin, not if we choose that route, we can choose to pay for our sin if we want to. But how many of y'all know this, though? We also still are called to the will of God in our lives. Did you know that? Jesus modeled it for us. We are still called to obey God in our lives and to finish the work to which he has called us. Can I get a better amen up in this Baptist church this morning? Hey, listen, Pastor Rick preached about this a few weeks ago on finishing strong, finishing the year strong, and that is good. But how about the rest of your life? How about that? You know, if you are alive in here, and I think most of you are. Sometimes I can't tell, you know, but I think most of y'all are. I know, you're raised in a culture that's quiet. I get it. Okay. But look, you're not quiet when the Razorbacks are winning. I promise you that. Listen, if you're alive in here, you are working on your legacy right now. In fact, sitting in the house of God, listening to the word of God being taught, you're working on your legacy. But right now, you're working on your legacy. So what you think, what you say, and what you do, and even what you don't think, and what you're not saying, and what you're not doing every day, every hour, every minute, you are creating your legacy. And the Bible talks about legacy a lot. God has a lot to say about it. And I want you to think about the idea of leaving a will, because this is a form of leaving a legacy, right? What are we doing when we create a will? Well, we're thinking about others, right, in the future. I'm not going to live here on this planet forever, so I'm thinking I'm going to leave some things that I love to people that I love, right? That's what a will is. And a lot of people think about financial assets, and that's certainly what a will is about. But I'm going to also say spiritual assets is a much bigger part of your legacy, okay? And look at Proverbs 13:22. A good man leaves an inheritance to his children's children. So a good person actually is thinking on three levels, three generations deep. Like right now, he's thinking about his family, but he's or she is thinking about their children as they become adults, and also thinking about their kids as well as they grow. Three levels of generation. Then I was looking at different things that people did in their wills, and some are kind of comical actually, but one man, this is pretty cool, one man in his will, he made provisions for a rose to be delivered to his wife every day for the rest of her life. Some of y'all are like, yeah, that's romantic right there. And you guys are like, man, why'd you have to say that? This is one woman, her name is Leona Helmsley. I guess she's a famous rich person. Anyway, she left $12 million to her dog. A court ruled against it and said a dog can only get $2 million. So I guess, thank God for the judiciary system. Okay, well, I don't know. In Portugal, I found this. A man left his fortune to 70 random people he found in the phone book. This was the best one, though. Listen to this. This is in Michigan. A guy named Wellington Burt. You may have heard of this. His will was known as the legacy of bitterness. Oh, y'all. He died in 1919, and his fortune, it was written this way, his fortune was to be released to his family 21 years after the death of his last grandchild. And this happened a few years ago. That actually happened. 12 family members were summoned into a lawyer's office. They had no clue, and those people split up $110 million in cash. Now listen, I love praying for unexpected sources of income for people, but some of you are wishing way too hard right now that you had a rich, bitter great-grandfather, and you just need to cut it out, all right? Okay. Somebody say, ain't gonna happen. He said, he knows his family. Hey, come on, everybody say legacy. Legacy, and that's what we're talking about. And some people wonder, like, why does it seem like even in the last decade or so, it's like things have gotten worse and worse, you know? Why does it seem like generationally, it feels like I don't know, the whole everything has gotten worse, you know? And people are like, who are to blame? Is it the government? Is it Democrats, right? It's the Republicans, somebody said, right? It's the Republicans, you know? They just go back and forth. It's the school system. It's Disney cartoons, man. All those innuendos, man, they're everywhere, right? It's Lady Gaga. It's got to be her. It's just, you know, who do you blame? I'm going to tell you, here's the problem. Are you ready? The problem is legacy, really. It's a failure to pass on the spiritual baton. We've forgotten how important it is to pass on a spiritual legacy to the next generation. And I'll show you this happened in the Bible in Judges with the Israelites. Look at Judges 2, verse 10. When all that generation, I love that, that generation is the one who loved God, saw his miracles. Look at this. But when all that generation had been gathered to their fathers, in other words, they passed away, another generation arose after them who did not know the Lord nor the work which he had done for Israel. There was a failure to pass on the baton. Do y'all see that? The other generation may have loved what God was doing, but they forgot to pass it on. And as a result, you can read this later in Judges. The Bible says everyone did as they saw fit in their own eyes. Like, you be you, man. Oh, you just believe the truth you want to believe. Live your own truth. Guys, that's not a new concept. It's ancient. It's right there in Judges. Satan is not running any new plays up in here, okay? This has been the same always. And so what I want to do is look at how important it is generationally speaking, naturally with your children, if you have children, but also spiritually, man. Like, how many of y'all know we can have some spiritual sons and daughters around us? No, I say that we're all called to have that. The Lord says that. That's what disciple making is all about. Amen? But let's look at some questions about your legacy right now. And here's the best part, guys. Here's the best part. With God, if you obey him, you get to change your life. In other words, no matter what legacy you were handed, you don't have to hand off that same legacy because of what Jesus did. You can leave a powerful legacy to spiritual sons and daughters and natural sons and daughters. Isn't that one of the most amazing things about God? That we get that ability. So three legacy questions. One of them is this. What will be your legacy of faith? It's a good question, right? What's going to be my legacy of faith? And what does it mean really to leave a legacy of faith? I want to take you to a passage where Paul is writing to his son in the faith, Timothy. But it's very interesting because in this passage, he's also referencing Timothy's natural family as well, his heritage. Look at 2 Timothy 1, 3 through 5. Paul says, I thank God whom I serve with a pure conscience as my forefathers did, as without ceasing I remember you in my prayers night and day, talking to Timothy, greatly desiring to see you, being mindful of your tears, that I may be filled with joy, when I call to remembrance the genuine faith that is in you, which dwelt first in your grandmother Lois and your mother Eunice, and I am persuaded is in you also. Isn't that awesome? Way to go, Lois. You did something right. And Eunice, you did something right. You raised up Timothy in the way that he should go. Isn't this amazing? So here's what I'm getting out of this verse. Will the way I'm living for God right now, will it affect my grandkids? Isn't that a great thought? And the answer is yes, the way I'm living always will. But I'm saying the way that I'm living for God, that's a legacy of faith. And here's some things that a strong legacy of faith says. One thing is this, we believe God even when we don't see. Y'all with me? That's a legacy of faith. If you can pass that along, you've done good. And by the way, all of you in here know how to operate in faith. You want to know how I know? Turn on the shower. You want that hot water, don't you? You turn on the hot water. But what comes on instead? It's cold, right? Right? But you're not fretting about it because you know it's coming. It's like you, that's called faith. It's faith. It's like you see one thing, but you know what? You're like, oh, I know something's happening that's going to turn in my favor. It's about to get hot up in here. You have no problem believing that, do you? You have faith in your shower. That's why. Hebrews, you know how to have faith. Hebrews 11, 1, it's the same thing, guys. Look at this. Faith is being sure of what we hope for and certain of what we do not see. See, faith is visualizing. That's what it is, the future. It's visualizing potential, but it's seeing it in advance. It's not just positive thinking, though, guys. It's what you're believing. You're believing God, believing what he says in his word. That's why it's very important to know his word, what it says about you, your family, your future. Amen? Some people say, well, I'll believe it when I see it. God says the exact opposite is true. You'll see it when you believe it first. When you believe me first, then you'll see it. Another statement of faith that is part of your legacy is that we obey God. Come on. We obey God even when we don't understand. How about passing that along to your natural and spiritual children? We obey. We do. We obey God even when we don't understand. That speaks to trust, doesn't it? Look, this is one of the most powerful things as a leader, as a parent, as anyone who wants to leave a spiritual legacy of faith, is this attitude. You know, I don't really understand everything that God is up to right now, but I do know one thing. We are following him. That's what I know. And look, most people want to follow God after they've got an ironclad guarantee of success. And I get that. I've told you this before. I was an engineer. I was trained to think conservatively. And as I've told you before, you're very happy about that. When you drive over a bridge, you are glad that the design engineer on that bridge was thinking safety first. You know, let's just play it safe. That's great. But with God, it doesn't happen that way, does it? It's not like that. He's never given you those kinds of guarantees. You know why? Because this is a faith walk. I'm going to obey him even when I don't understand him. Y'all still here? Who in the Bible demonstrated that? Well, a lot of people. But I think about Noah. Remember him? God is saying, listen, Noah, I need you to build a boat. It's going to rain. And Noah's like, time out. What's rain? He had to be thinking it. It had never rained until that point. I mean, heavy dew, mist, fog, whatever, but it didn't rain. We don't really know for sure. Okay, so Noah, it's going to flood. What's a flood? Build a boat, right? And look at this. Hebrews 11:7 says this. This is like the hall of fame of faith. That's what Hebrews 11 is. It says, it was by faith that Noah built an ark to save his family from the flood. Get this. He obeyed God, who warned him about something that had never happened. That's good. And you know what? That's a heart with faith. That's somebody, that is a heart that says, I'm going to obey God even though I've never seen it before. I'm going to obey him in advance, right? He trusts God. And I'm telling you, in your life, you can either trust God or trust your gut. Guess which one is better? You can trust the word of God or you can trust the world. In all kinds of issues. Yes, like tithing, like waiting until marriage to have sex. All these different kinds of issues, man. I could go on and on. How about just loving your enemies? Y'all still here? Look, a legacy of faith says this. I trust God. He's a good father. And I trust that he has my best interest in his mind. And that's what I'm trusting. Amen? Y'all ready for number two? Question number two? Y'all ready? Okay, you can go ahead and show it. What will be your legacy of convictions? We talked about faith. Let's talk about what your legacy will be of convictions. You know what a conviction is? People, you understand that? It's very different than an opinion, right? Conviction is a value that is very, very deep in your life. You'll bleed for it. You'll die for it. It guides your life, right? I mentioned it's deeper than an opinion because, you know, everybody will argue over opinions, but you'll die for a conviction. That's a conviction in your life. And so in your life, you're gonna make decisions by a couple of different criteria. One of them is, what's the easiest thing to do? That's one way you can make decisions, right? What's easier for me? Another way you can make decisions is, what is everyone else saying? Or you can make decisions based on this. What do my convictions tell me? What are my convictions? What are the convictions of my life? Because this is what matters most. You really want to direct your life around that, by the way. Okay? And just talk about, I want to give you a couple of biblical convictions that are very powerful in your life. And one of them is this. Life is all about God. Can y'all say that with me? Life is all about God. You know what that means? It's not all about me. It's not all about you either. Me, when you say me, it means me, okay? Hey, you want to raise some kids to be some super insecure adults? Yeah, like, don't anybody raise your hand on that one. I'll tell you how to do it. Raise them to think that the world revolves around them. Because it doesn't. It revolves around God. And until you understand that and get that right in your head, your life is not going to make sense. I exist to bring glory to God. I exist to bring glory to God, just like Jesus modeled. We just talked about that. Look at Romans 11:36, man. This is where the sermon gets good. Oh my goodness, this is one of my favorites. Romans 11:36. Look at this. For everything, if you do an intense word study on that, guess what it means? Man, you guys are scholars. Okay, for everything comes from God alone. Everything lives by his power. You know, I've often said this. He could snap his fingers. He could say the word, and we wouldn't exist anymore. Somebody just made a Thanos reference. I love it. Look at this last phrase. Everything is intended for his glory. It was by him that we were created. It's for his glory that we're created. It's for his good pleasure, the Bible says. Come on, you need to memorize this part of this verse. Everything is intended for his glory. Can we just get that today? Everything on the planet and in the universe and everything that will be was created for God's glory. And you got to decide, like, what are you living for in your life? And not only that, what are you going to love most in your life? Is it going to be the one who gave you life? Or is it going to be something else? What do you love? A couple of weeks ago, we talked about how we can lose our first love. Remember that? Raise your hand if you remember that. I don't know. Maybe, okay, five of y'all remember that. It's the Church of Ephesus. Remember them? And in the book of Revelation, Jesus wrote a letter to the book of Ephesus and said, y'all, you've lost your first love. You fell out of love with me, he said. And I talked to y'all about remembering maybe your first love, how when you dated your spouse initially, what it was like. Look, I was thinking about that again this week. And when Kamani and I were, when we started dating, I was at LSU, go Tigers, and Kamani was still in high school. So I would schedule all my classes so that I would be done on Friday at noon so that I could get in my Toyota Tercel and I could max that sucker out speeding, like maxing it out, is rattling, bolts are flying out of it, so I could get home in time to pick her up when high school let out on Friday afternoon. Hey there. It wasn't exactly like that, but kind of. First love. Everybody say first love. That's what it does. It continues to drive you back into the presence of the one you love. Is that my legacy that I'm passing on to my children? Right? That God, that my life is all about God. He's my first love. Am I passing that conviction on? Good question, right? Here's another conviction. Every person in the world needs Jesus. This is a biblical conviction. Look at this in Matthew chapter 28. Is this your conviction? Is this your life conviction that everyone in the world needs Jesus? Matthew 28, 18 through 20. Jesus said this about himself and about us. He said, all authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Therefore, go. Everybody say, go. That is an assignment. All right? But what's our assignment? He tells us. And make disciples, like disciples of Christ, right? Of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I've commanded you. And look at this. I am with you always to the very end of the age. Man, so he's saying, look, you got a job. You go and you make disciples. You help them grow in their relationship with me. You do that. And look, and it means everywhere, everywhere, to the ends of the earth, to the ends of the age, man. Man, there is no place that this church will not go to reach a soul. Man, Pastor Rick, if you knew him personally, I'm convinced that man would take a trip to hell if he thought he could save one person. And that's where we get this personality from. But you know where we get it ultimately from? That's Jesus. That's his heart. Anybody thankful for that? John 3:17, this is what Jesus said. I did not come to condemn the world. I came to save it. And listen, I want to be more like that. I want to be like Jesus. And I want my kids to be like Jesus. I want you to be like Jesus. Is that our conviction? That should be a conviction. Amen? All right, how about this last question we can ask ourselves? So we talked about faith. We talked about convictions. But what will be your legacy of giving? Pastor, why you got to talk about giving? because you cannot separate giving from a very important concept, maybe the most important concept in the kingdom of God, love. You know why? Because love says, I want to give to you. Y'all with me? Love says, I want to meet your needs. Love says, I care about you. I want to serve you. Now you see, love is the exact opposite of lust. Lust says, I'm getting something from you. I need something and I'm taking it. Versus, I want something for you. Do y'all see the difference? Love is giving. Generosity, that's the heart behind love. That's what it is. Generosity is the heart of love. And look, you cannot love somebody without being generous. You ever thought about that? Because love is giving, right? It is giving. It's laying your life down. It's giving. And I can say this. We have some very loving people in our church. Did y'all know that? Well, Pastor, how can you tell that? You don't. Yeah, I can tell. You know why? Because we have some very generous people in our church. Give of their time. Like some of you just will sit and listen to other people. Giving your time with people. Giving your resources, your money. Absolutely. Giving to our church family, helping us do what we're called to do. Man, that's loving. That's loving. Giving is loving. Giving of your talents, like all of this, but also your words. Man, you can be generous with your words. Here's a point to remember. God is the greatest giver. That's where we get the trait from. It's his character, right? We get the giving nature from him, right? Generosity actually displays the character of God. So here's what I'm going to tell you. When I see someone being generous, when I see a giving person, I am seeing exactly a picture of what God looks like. That's why it's so powerful. God is a giver. Here, I'll give you an illustration. Okay, I want everybody to do this for me. Everybody breathe in. Come on. It's so funny. My wife has an app on her iPhone that reminds her to breathe. It's like, I'm like, that's so useful. Anyway, so come on, breathe in. Now breathe out. Okay, that air you just breathed, that was a gift from God. That's a gift from God. He's a giver. Look at John 1:16 in the Message paraphrase. We all live off God's generous bounty, gift after gift after gift. And that, again, goes back to why we're a giving people. Hey, New Life Church, you're a giving people. We are very giving. In fact, next week, we're going to take a missions offering. I know we said it was going to be this week. We lied. It's actually going to be next week. Forgive us. Look, next week, because the rest of New Life Church, we're all doing this together next week, a missions offering. But I just thought I would tell you a little bit. So we're talking about a legacy of giving. So let me tell you a little bit about what we did this year, what you were able to do this year. Christmas Mall, you ever heard of that? Yeah, it just happened this weekend. You saw the video. It's amazing. This was our 10th year of doing it here in Heber Springs. And we were able to help over 200 families with the love of God. I mean, that's pretty cool. But then let me just tell you about our outreach campus, our outreach efforts in general at New Life Church. We are continually feeding the hungry in this place. Y'all know this. Y'all saw what we did in the summer, and especially with COVID hitting. I mean, we're doing that. And we don't just help the poor with food. We help them with material stuff, and we pray with people. Here's a cool stat. Across the state, New Life Church has helped serve 1.2 million meals to kids and families this year. That's insane. You can give God a hand for that. Give yourselves a hand. And then CityServe, a lot of you guys know that we have a partnership with them. And through our partnership with them, what we do is we have access to all kind of home goods like furniture and appliances and everything, curtains, you name it, everything. And from companies like Costco and others who give stuff to us. And so we turn around and we give these things to our communities, people in need. It is amazing to be a part of. But I was doing some investigation here this week, and I got a report about our return on investment in that system. Now, some of you have no idea what that is, but some of you investors, you know what that term is, ROI, return on investment. for our location right here of New Life Church, for every dollar we put into that system, we got $91 back of goods we gave away this year. Yeah, I can tell who the investors are in here. They just got shocked. Okay. Just in this first year alone, listen to this. I got to tell you this. We've been able to bless people. I'm talking about right here locally with over $860,000 worth of goods into this community in this area. That is a crazy ROI. I'm talking about people who are being financially blessed. As a church whole over the state, it was $3.4 million. And man, I know it's crazy. So that's return on investment. And it's only getting better as we have people like Amazon is jumping in with us now. It's incredible. We're getting some fun stuff from them now. That's pretty wild. It's like going to Vegas, man. Open up a box. Look at this. What we got here. It's so fun, y'all. Hey, listen. Let me tell you what. Here's a promise. You get involved with us giving. Yes, and serving the poor with us. And you're going to see clearly how much God is blessing us to bless the poor. It is supernatural favor. Okay. And then the Ark, man, we're planting churches. The Ark, just this year alone, we planted 57 new churches in this year with the Ark. And the Ark gave $400,000 to churches in need. There's a lot of need during COVID. And let me back up and say something about blessing other ministries in this area because it's so fun. We were able to bless, just this week, four different ministries in our area. Y'all know The Call, maybe you've heard of them. The Other Side, Margie's Haven House, Freedom Way Ministries. You know, these people are people in our community who are always loving the least of these. And we're like, hey, we just want to financially bless you. We were able to do that this week. You were able to do that. The Surge, that's our international effort. New Life Church helped plant 46 churches around the world this year. And so next week, we're going to do this thing called a legacy offering. Everything we take up next week is going to be about missions, local, national, and global. And we've already done the things I'm talking about. And I don't have time to even tell you about M18, which is our recovery, addiction recovery house, our own New Life Church recovery house for men that have addictions. In Little Rock, we're going to expand that. Look, if you're in our database, you received a letter. And it explains everything we're going to do. Because I'm talking about we're going to do these projects regardless of if you give or not. But this offering next week is going to offset costs for us next year as we move forward in the plan of God. So we're giving the whole of New Life Church just a chance, just whatever. In fact, we love to see just everybody do a little something, you know. And enough about that. Maybe, though, listen to me right now. Maybe you've allowed this year, it's been so crazy. Maybe you've allowed this year to sideline you in finishing the work that God has assigned to you. Let me show you this verse in Galatians 5, because this is the same thing the Galatian church, good church, but they were having some of these problems. Paul said, you were running a good race. Who cut in on you to keep you from obeying the truth? That kind of persuasion does not come from the one who calls you. Okay. Here, if you don't get anything else, please get this. It is not too late to hop back in the race with us and to finish the work God has called you to with your church family. It is not too late. Get in with us. And you know, sometimes as Christians, we make it so confusing. God, what should I do? Here's a better question. Have I done what God is already asking me to do? Way simpler. So I'm saying, come on, commit or recommit to doing those things you already know God has asked you to do in the Word of God, like regular giving to your local church. If you haven't lost your job, like a lot of people have this year, and that's a real issue. We're helping those people. Or just serving. Look, serve the poor with us. Serve your church with us. Get involved. Get in a small group, right? Invest in those relationships. Like I talked about earlier, that's loving them. It's the way you receive love as well. Hey, here's a big one. Spend intentional time with God. If He is your life, wake up every morning like He is. And say, God, just, I'm talking about spend time with Him. God, here's what's going on now. I love you. I got this going on. I need you. Get in His Word and hear what He has to say to you. Can we just do that? Commit, recommit to that. Have some devotional time with your family. I know it's tough sometimes. I got kids. It's like stabbing my eyeballs out sometimes. Okay, listen, I understand that. But you know what? Just do it. Just share with them what you're learning. A verse. Pray with your kids. Y'all still here? Commit to doing these things, man. And I started off talking about finishing strong. Jesus finished strong. Paul did too. Listen to what he said in Acts chapter 20, verse 24. And there were prophets there saying, hey, don't go to Jerusalem. They're going to kill you down there. And he said, whatever, man. If that's the will of God, so be it. Did y'all hear that? These weren't false prophets. They're telling the truth. And he said, but my life is worth nothing to me unless I use it. Boy, I could talk about the word there. God's given you a life. Use it. He said, my life is worth nothing to me unless I use it for finishing the work. Does that sound like somebody else? Doesn't that sound like Jesus? Unless I use it for finishing the work assigned me by the Lord Jesus. Gosh, man, we can learn. That's legacy right there. And what's His work? Telling people about the grace that's in Jesus. The truth of the grace of God. Amen? Can you bow your heads with me? I just want to pray for our church. Lord, I just lift up our church right now. New Life Church. Statewide, but specifically this church family we're a part of here in Heber Springs, Cleburne County, Arkansas, right here in this beautiful place. God, You have called us for such a time as this. I believe on the edge of the end times. Lord, it's time for the body of Christ to step up and be the army You've called us to be. And so, Lord, I ask that You would forgive us where sometimes we just, you know, we get distracted and all these things we've been learning in the life of Christ. God, I thank You for every person in here that they're going to leave a legacy. Lord, a legacy of loving You. And God, their life is all about You, Lord, that You would help them to leave a long and strong legacy of faith. Their kids, and natural and spiritual, would have that faith they have. And Lord, that they would have convictions that they're predecessors can be proud of and can copy. God, I pray that every one of us at New Life Church, Lord, would also leave a legacy of giving, because God, You are giving. Lord, I pray that You would call us to radical, crazy, loving generosity this year. There's no end to what we can do with You when we have a church that's modeled after Your kind of love. And so, Lord, I pray that You would make it happen. Come on, convict us where we need to be convicted. We welcome You, Holy Spirit. God, the things that You've already revealed to us in Your word and as individuals, Lord, we're going to recommit to doing those things, to loving You well by loving others, God. Hey, no one else looking around, if you're here and you would say, well, I need Jesus in my life. That's what I need. That's why I'm here. I told you the early part of the sermon that He died for you so you wouldn't have to spend eternity separated from God. But if you're here and you would say, I want to put my faith in what He did for me. I want a brand new life in Him. There may be no one here that fits that criteria. Or maybe there's somebody that is here that say, I did make that decision one time, but man, I need to recommit my walk to Him because my life doesn't look anything like what we described today. If any of those of you, just raise your hand. I'm not going to point you out, but I want to know who I'm praying for. Raise your hand boldly toward heaven and look up at me if that's you. Yes, sir. Anybody else? You can put down your hand if I see you. Just looking for people that want in on this time of business with God. All right, you can put your hands down. If you're watching by video, pray this prayer as well. If that's you, just pray this way. Lord, I believe in You. I can't physically see You, but by the Holy Spirit, I know that You're drawing me to Yourself. So come into my life. Forgive me. Fix me on the inside, because I cannot do it. Jesus, thank You for dying so that I could know my Father in heaven forever. Give me that brand new life. Thank you for getting up out of the grave and having a new life. I need that new life. Give it to me, please. I believe you're giving me that now. It's in Jesus' name I pray. Amen and amen. Come on, let's give God a hand right now.